There are some instances of engineering systems where we have to model the elastic elements via springs of different stiffness, okay? And the springs could be attached in series or they could be attached in parallel. So let's see what happens when we have more than one spring. So let's start with case one of parallel springs. So parallel springs. So how do we have the parallel spring? So we can have one spring, another spring. So let's say this is of stiffness K1, this is K2, and there is a mass M, which is attached to these two springs. Okay, so how do we do the analysis in this case? So what happens when you have two springs? So again, equilibrium analysis, let's do that first. Equilibrium analysis is, you draw the free body diagram in equilibrium. So we have K1, delta static, K2, delta static. Why this is same? Because it's tied to the same mass and the mass is only allowed to do the translation, cannot rotate. So when this is pulled down by a certain amount, both the springs are stretched by the same amount. The stretch is same. So in equilibrium, mg should be equal to K1 plus K2 delta static. Okay, and now I'm going to displace it by amount x. That's the process we will be using. So we'll do the equilibrium analysis and then we'll displace the particle from its equilibrium position in one of the directions. And the choice of direction is completely arbitrary. I could move it even up or down. Whichever direction I pick to choose the displacement direction would become the positive direction, okay? So let's say I displace it by amount x, and you draw the free body diagram again. You have the weight. This is K1 delta static plus x, K2 delta static plus x, okay? Sigma F equal to Ma. G is K1 okay, we've already seen that these two are same, which means that MG will cancel with these two and we will be left with MX double down plus K1 plus K2 times X equal to 0. We'll put it in the standard form by dividing with M, so X double dot plus K1 plus K2 over M times X equal to 0. And that is our standard form, right? So this is our standard form. And remember, the standard form is obtained by making sure that the coefficient of X double dot is 1, okay? Now, if you look at this particular equation of motion, this is same as what we obtained before, right? Before, for a simple harmonic oscillator, our standard form looked like X double dot plus omega N squared X equal to 0. So from equation of motion, you could actually see what the circular natural frequency was. And if you compare this with this, they are same forms, except that your circular natural frequency is equal to over here, square root of K1 plus K2 over M. So it's almost as if you took these two springs and you added their stiffness and formed an equivalent spring of a stiffness K1 plus K2, right? So this whole system is equivalent to a single spring mass system where the effective spring constant is K1 plus K2. So if you see two springs in parallel, you can effectively add their stiffness and replace them with one single spring of effective K equal to a sum total of the spring constant of both the springs. So this is almost a situation similar to what you have with the resistances in the resistors in the circuits, electrical circuits, where you have two resistors in series, they get added together. And here we have two springs in parallel. So springs in parallel are almost like resistors in series. So since we talk about the parallel springs, let's also talk about springs in series, right? So springs in series. So what happens when the springs are in series? So we have a situation where we have two springs now, let's say K2 and K1, and there is a mass M tied to them, okay? Now what happens in this case? Well, we can definitely do the static analysis, right? But we've already seen that what happens in the equilibrium is really not important. In fact, it cancels out. So you can do that, but you know, I'm not going to bother with that anymore. So we'll see what happens when it is displaced by amount X, okay? So if I pull the M down by amount X, the first question is, what is the stretch in the spring number one, and what is the stretch in the spring number two. So if you pull, let's say, M down by amount X, what is the stretch in the first spring? So this is the first spring you're talking about. So this is the first spring, and this is the second spring. So what is the stretch in the first spring? Is it amount X? Well, that depends on what is the movement of this common point between the two strings like, right? So we cannot be sure that this point will come down by the same amount. So let's assume that this is actually X prime. So the point, the common point between the two springs moves down by amount X prime when this end of the spring moves down by amount X. So if X is more than X prime, and we can assume that if X is more than X prime, then clearly the first spring is going to be stretched, right? And what will be the amount of stretch? It will be X minus X prime. So if you just draw the first spring, this is what it looks like. This is K1. This point comes down by amount X. This point comes down by amount X prime. And the total stretch, so let's call it, you know, delta stretch is equal to X minus X prime, right? If X was less than X prime, then we would say it is actually compressed. But it doesn't matter. We will just assume this is actually stretched. So if that is a total stretch in the spring, then what is the force developed? What is the force developed in the spring? It will be K1 times the delta stretch, which is X minus X prime, right? So the same force here would be K1 X minus X prime, right? If you look at the spring number two, for the spring number two, and I'm going to draw it on this side, look at the spring number two, this point is coming down by amount X prime, okay? So which means that the force would be X K2 X prime, and here the force would be same, which is K2 X prime, right? And the forces have to be, of course, same because we're assuming that these springs are massless, okay? So that's the situation. Okay, so now let's write sigma F equal to ma for the mass, right? Sigma F equal to ma. Okay, so what are the forces on the particle, right? So if you draw the free body of the particle, we have the force from the spring one, which is basically this, right? From Newton's third law, this force has to be same. So that's K1 X minus X prime, right? So the only force is this. And remember, the gravity will be balanced by what happens in equilibrium, as we have seen before. So we don't need to bother about that. We have minus K1 X minus X prime equal to M times X double dot, right? Now, this is not a very happy situation because it looks like we have more than one variable. We have X, we have X prime. So we should get rid of X prime somehow from this, okay? Which we can, because if you look at this common point, let's call this point C. This is the point C. This is the point C over here for spring one. And this is the point C for the spring two, right? So this force over here and this force over here have to be same, right? Because it's a common point. Otherwise, that point would basically come apart. So we can say that K1 X minus X prime should be equal to K2 X prime. So what do we get if we simplify this? I'll take X2 X prime on the other side, and I'll get K2 plus K1 X prime. So that gives us X prime as K1 over K1 plus K2 times X. That's great. We can substitute for this X prime in here and see what we get. So we get minus K1 X minus K1 over K1 plus K2 times X equal to MX double dot. Remember, our goal is to write only in terms of position variable X. So what do we get? We get minus K1, X comes out, and this becomes K1 plus K2 minus K1 over K1 plus K2. Okay, so K1 cancels, so we get what? MX double dot plus K1, K2 over K1 plus K2, X equal to zero. And we can put this in the standard form by getting rid of M from here and dividing by M over here. Okay, so that becomes your standard form because we made the coefficient of X double dot to be 1. Okay, so if we look at this, this also looks very similar to what we have obtained before, right? We have X double dot, which stands all by itself. And then on the right hand, on the second term is something times X, right? And we have the same thing over here. Except that K, effective K, is over here. So if this is to be replaced with the signal equation, X double dot plus K effective over M, X equal to zero, then K effective is K1, K2 over K1 plus K2. We can also write this as 1 over k effective equal to 1 over k1 plus 1 over k2. And this also looks kind of familiar. So if you remember your electrical circuits from Mech 101 or an equivalent class, you know that if you have two resistors in parallel, then their effective resistance is added together in this way. So if you were looking for effective resistance of two resistors in parallel, you would do 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2, and that would be equal to 1 over R effective, right? So here the springs are in series. So springs in series behave like resistors in parallel, springs in parallel behave like resistors in series, right? So that's sort of a reciprocal relationship that springs have with the resistors, you know. And of course, another one of the common things is that they're both shown by a squiggly line. That's almost a coincidence. So if you have two springs in series, the effective spring constant is given by this number over here. So if you can determine that, then you can also determine what the circular natural frequency would be. That would be square root of k effective over m, right? So just knowing the spring constant and the mass of the particle, you can at least determine the circular natural frequency. And all these systems, whether you have two springs in parallel or two springs in series, are solved by the same equation, which is given by x equal to xm sine omega nt plus phi. What the omega n would be is determined by, you know, what kind of k you have and what kind of m you have. So let's do a simple example. So let's say I have springs like this. Okay. And just to keep things simple, I would say that all of these have same spring constant. So we have some particle of mass m, and we are modeling elastic elements attached to this particle via four springs. Okay, so let's try to find what the effective spring constant would be for all these four springs over here. So the idea is to replace this four spring and one particle system with a single spring and mass system, so k effective. Okay, so let's see. So we have these two which are in series, so we can determine their effective k. That would be given by k1 k2 times k1 k2 divided by k1 plus k2. So effective k of these two would be equal to k times k over k plus k, that's 2k, so that's actually k by 2, right? Similarly, the effective k of these two, which are in series, will be given by k by 2. And then this k by 2, this k by 2 are in parallel, so we'll add their spring constant, and we'll get basically just 1k. So effective k of this four spring and one mass system is given by a single k and mass, right? So if you were to just replace all four of these with one spring constant k, that would be the same thing. So if I gave you the spring constant k, let's say, I don't know, we'll call it maybe 10 newton per meter, and I gave you the mass to be, let's say, 1 kilogram, and I said, you know, from this, can you tell me what the natural frequency is, circular natural frequency? That'll be easy to determine. Omega n is equal to square root of k over m, you know, k effective, so that's square root of 10 over 1, so that's basically square root of 10 radians per second. Okay, so this is not per second, that's just the frequency. This is circular natural frequency, and that's why the units are radian per second. Let's do another example. So let's say I have again a ceiling, I have a mass m, and I have one spring like this, another spring like this, let's say k, another goes like this, another goes like this. Okay, all right, so let's say, you know, we have a mass and you have four springs attached like that. Now the question is, you know, what is the configuration of these springs? Which springs are in series, which springs are in parallel? In the previous example, it was, you know, very, very clear as to which ones are in series, which ones were in parallel, right? So if you look at this problem, you know, you might conclude that, hey, you know, this one, this particular spring looks like in series with this one, because they're, you know, essentially along the same line, right? But reality is that these two are actually not in series, they're in parallel. So this one and this one are actually in parallel with each other. And how do we really determine, you know, whether something is in parallel series or not? So if you remember how you determine if resistors were in parallel series or not, was that if the resistors, if there was same potential difference or voltage difference applied across the resistor, we said that they were in parallel, right? And if the same current flowed through the resistors, then we said they were in series. So we have a similar test for the spring as well. So essentially what you have to do is you have to deform the spring. So you have to move the particle and see if the springs is stretched or compressed by the same amount or not. if the springs are stretched and compressed by the same amount, then those springs are in parallel. Okay, so let me write that test. If the springs stretch or compress by same amount, then they are in parallel. Okay, so let's go back to, you know, what we are seeing over here. Clearly, these two springs over here were not stretching by the same amount, not in general. Okay, so that means that they were not in parallel. Now, if you look over here, when you displace this particle M in the downward rotation by amount X, this spring over here will be stretched by amount X, and this spring over here, the second spring, will also be compressed by the same amount of X, right? Which means that both of them would be exerting a force in the opposite direction of the motion, which will be equal to K times X. And that means that their effective K would add up together, right? Same thing with these two. So in a sense, all of these springs over here are in parallel, even though it looks like as if two of them are in series and then another two of them are in series and then they are in parallel with each other. The reality is that all of these four springs are in parallel, which means that this whole system could be replaced via something like this. So all these four springs have the same stiffness, and that means the effective K for this would be equal to, you know, 4K, all right? So don't be misled by just the diagram. You have to really look at how the springs stretch or compress. If the springs move by the same amount, then they're all in parallel. If they don't move by the same amount, then they will be